have this lab, we'll be posting this lab very soon for this week. Also, your homework will also be posted very soon as well. We have open lab today, if you guys are interested in that, from 1:30 to 3:30. And like I said before, the last, not this week, but next week, I'm going to put out the arm and leg models in the study room. However, I'm not putting out the torso models. They're just too expensive and I don't want them getting up and walking away. In addition to that, remember that I will also be posting additional lab times, and we're gonna, next week we're gonna have, well, I already know what they're gonna be, but I can tell you right now, but I'll make an announcement as well. So next week, our open lab is gonna be Friday from 1:30 to 3, I'm sorry, let me back up. Monday and Wednesday from 1:30 to 3:30, and then we're going to do a Thursday from 12 to 3. Monday, Wednesday, 1:30 to 3:30, and then Thursday from 12 to 3. Again, Friday is Veterans Day, so the school will be closed on that day. So that is gonna be your last opportunity to get any open lab time in, because as you know, the week after, then we're gonna take test number 3. Okay, all right. So we're continuing on here with muscles. and this week in lab, you guys will be happy to know that we're gonna kind of venture away from the muscles. I understand, like I've said before, that this is tedious information, but it is necessary. This week in lab, we're gonna focus on physiology, which is gonna be a lot more engaging in my humble opinion. And I think you guys will enjoy that. So we're looking at now muscles of the elbow joint. And these are muscles that flex and extend the forearm. And we'll just, you know, you can look at these charts later. I'm gonna go over every single one of these, show you guys here. So let's watch a little quick little video first.
The elbow joint is a hinge joint. Therefore, the muscles that act on this joint are limited to flexion and extension of the forearm at the humero-ulnar joint, while the forearm itself is capable of pronation and supination.
Okay, so to add to this, elbow joint is a synovial joint, as you guys should know, so it has all those typical synovial features, the cartilage, the synovial membrane, the synovial fluid. It is the only true hinge joint in the body. And as you know, a true hinge joint allows for that diarthrosis movement because it is a synovial joint and it allows for flexion and extension to take place, right? Okay. Now, I don't want you guys to get confused, because what happens here is that we're going to get pronation and supination of the forearm as well. But that's not from the elbow joint. The elbow joint itself is only where the trochlear notch of the ulna fits into that trochlea of the humerus.
Muscles that extend the forearm are located posteriorly, while those associated with flexion of the forearm are located anteriorly.
Okay, so muscles crossing the elbow joint are involved with this. Ready? Here it goes. Flexion of the forearm and extension of the forearm. So with that being said, we can divide those muscles into two different compartments, if you will. There's anterior muscles and posterior muscles.
The forearm extensors consist of the anconeus and the triceps brachii. The anconeus originates on the lateral epicondyle of the humerus and inserts on the olecranon process of the ulna. The triceps brachii is a three-headed muscle with the long head originating on the infraglenoid tubercle of the scapula and the lateral and medial heads originating on the posterior shaft of the humerus. The heads come together distally to to insert on the olecranon process of the ulna.
Okay. So this should be nothing new for you guys, considering if you've done your homework, you know that the triceps, try referring to, again, three origins, biceps, two origins, quads, four origins, right? And we have the triceps, the short head is on the cork, the short head and the lateral head both originate from the actual humerus, whereas the long head originates from the infraglenoid tubercle, the scapula. All of these muscles are gonna merge and insert there in the olecranon process. And of course, when they contract, it's going to, this is the prime mover agonist of extension of the forearm. In whatever fashion you wanna do it, it extends the forearm. Now, there's a very small synergistic muscle that I haven't mentioned yet. And I don't even know if that's listed in the lab. I don't think it is. It's called the Inconius. And it's very minor. Again, the major ones that are doing this movement are triceps. And here they are. You can see this is the triceps with its three heads, two coming from the humerus itself, and the other one coming from the infraglenoid tubercle of the scapula.
Triceps brachii is the large extensor muscle located in the posterior compartment of the arm. It has three heads of origin, the long head, the lateral head, and the medial head. The origin of the long head is from the infraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. The origins of the lateral head are from the posterior and lateral surfaces of the superior one half of the humerus. It is located both superiorly and laterally to the radial groove. The origins of the medial head are from the inferior two-thirds of the medial and posterior surfaces of the humerus and is located inferiorly to the radial groove. Together, the three heads insert onto the superior and posterior surfaces of the olecranon process of the ulna. Triceps brachii extend the forearm at the elbow. It is innervated by the radial nerve.
Okay, now again, all these nerves, you really don't have to pay attention to those. You're not going to be responsible for knowing those yet. So it's probably a good idea to just, understand, first off, that, we have these various nerves that are going to innervate. These muscles are only going to contract in a normal, healthy individual. They're only going to contract if they're told to or signaled to by a particular nerve. And we'll talk about, this is in a few weeks' time, we're going to actually talk about the different nerve placement of the body as well.
The forearm flexors consist of the brachials, the brachioradialis, and the biceps brachii. The brachialis muscle originates on the front distal half of the humerus and inserts on the coronoid process of the ulna.
That's a real deep muscle, by the way.
The brachioradialis originates on the lateral supracondylar ridge of the humerus and inserts on the base of the styloid process of the radius. The biceps brachii has two parts, a long head and a short head. The short head originates on the coracoid process of the scapula, while the long head originates on the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. The two heads of the biceps come together distally to insert on the radial tuberosity, just distal to the elbow joint.
Okay, so one of the things you should realize again, and I can't remember if I've mentioned this before, I think I did in lab, is that all of the muscles of the limbs, they're compartmentalized, meaning that there's actually fascia, it's called deep fascia, it's dense irregular connective tissue, that surrounds these muscles in sections. And so, in other words, they are walled off, if you will, from this other musculature. Now, the reason why I mention that is, there's some instances where if you get, a lot of damage to a particular area, someone hits you real hard, or a crushing injury. Well, this is, you know, let's say this particular, you know, this anterior compartment here of your arm got crushed, and now you're going to suffer from a bunch of inflammation. Well, that can be dangerous due to the fact that if this, you know, this, think about this as like a leather bag. It's going to expand to the compartment, the fascia. It's going to expand to a certain extent, and then it won't expand anymore. Well, that can be dangerous because as it stops expanding, well, inflammation is still going to kick in, and you're going to get this skyrocketing of pressure in that particular area. And where the danger falls is when that pressure in that compartment gets larger or higher than blood pressure, then the blood is not going to flow and through and perfuse that tissue anymore. And you can actually, you know, suffer from tissue death if that, you know, lingers for too long of a period. So if you guys have ever heard of a fasciotomy before, it's in this condition where there's so much pressure built up, they'll actually go in and they'll cut that fascia, and it releases, you know, the muscle literally kind of bulges out of that compartment. And what they're doing is, they're doing that in order to relieve that extra pressure so you can actually get blood flow and perfuse that particular tissue. So, and you know, this is just one example out of many, many examples of compartmentalization of these muscles of the limbs. So here we go. This is, you can see again, and you know, what you need to get out of this is that here's the biceps and the brachialis. And these are the flexors, whereas on the, again, on the opposite side of the bone for the most part, then we have our extensors. So we have antagonistic muscle groups on opposite sides of the bone, and that's as usual, okay? Then we have the wrist flexors here, and we're gonna have also wrist extensors coming up in just a moment. So here is, we're kind of superimposing more of the superficial muscles. You can see here that the pectoralis major is a superficial muscle along with the deltoid, and these appear, you know, to kind of merge in together, but they are in fact separate muscles. And one of the things that, you know, if you've gone through my lab, you know this, you've heard me say this multiple times, is that there's a many, many lines of pull, if you will, or the fascicles of these broad muscles, in particular like the pectoralis major and the deltoid and the trapezius. Those are the three guys that have this line of pull in many different directions. You can see fibers running in this direction, which is gonna pull your arm downwards. You can see fibers running straight across, which is gonna pull your arm and adduct your arm, right? Horizontal adduct. And then you're also gonna have fibers running this way, and that's more of a flexion action. So your pectoralis major produces a lot of different movement because it has these fibers running in all of these different directions. Your deltoid is really the same. Your deltoid goes all the way, starts anteriorly, and goes all the way back and around. There are three parts to your deltoid. They're considered an anterior, there's a middle, and there's a posterior. And here's my anterior delt, okay? Here's my middle. And then here's the action of my posterior deltoid. Each one of these actions is the result of my deltoid muscles contracting, particular fibers of my deltoid muscle contracting. So you'll see here that, of course, the biceps brachii, the origin point is about this area, right? We've already spoken of that. So this is deep to these two muscle groups.
Biceps brachii is the large two-headed flexor muscle located in the anterior compartment of the arm. The origin of the long head is from the supraglenoid tubercle of the scapula. The origin of the short head is from the tip of the coracoid process of the scapula. The two heads insert by a common tendon onto the radial tuberosity and by the bicipital aponeurosis, which blends with the deep fascia on the medial aspect of the forearm. Biceps brachii flexes the forearm at the elbow supinates the forearm and weakly flexes the shoulder. It is innervated by the musculocutaneous nerve.
So here's one thing I didn't mention before. You know, I told you simply that the biceps is a forearm flexor, and that for the most part is its main job. However, there's a little bit of supination that when that bicep pulls on that radius, there's a little bit of supination that takes place as well. This is the deep muscle, so this is hidden underneath. Well, not hidden, but it is underneath the biceps.
The origin of brachialis is from the distal one half of the anterior surface of the humerus and adjacent intermuscular septa. The insertion is to the tuberosity and coronoid process of the ulna.
That's why the tuberosity of the ulna is there.
Brachialis flexes the forearm at the elbow. It is innervated by the musculocutaneous nerve and a small branch of the radial nerve.
So this muscle is simply a forearm flexor. Does everybody see that? It only crosses the elbow joint, and when it pulls, it creates this movement. Now the biceps, because they cross the shoulder joint as well, they're the prime movers for flexion of the forearm. However, there's a little bit of flexion of the arm that's created by the biceps, because remember, if I haven't said this to you before, please, you know this. If a muscle crosses a joint, it's gonna have at least one action. If it crosses two joints, therefore it's gonna have at least two actions, because it's gonna work on both of those joints. It's gonna have some influence on the way that that bone moves between those joints, okay? Last but not least, our last flexor, our synergistic flexor.
The origin of brachioradialis is from the lateral supracondylar ridge of the humerus. The insertion is to the base of the styloid process of the radius. Brachioradialis is an especially strong forearm flexor when the forearm is in a semi-pronated position.
So you see that action there? That's, you know, for you gym folk, that's like hammer curls. If you do hammer curls, where you just come straight up like this. Hammer curls are hitting that particular muscle now because you're not supinating, you're more pronating at that point. So it's gonna hit that muscle more in a pronated position.
It's innervated by the deep radial nerve.
Okay, well, another thing that we need to talk about is that most muscles or flexors insert via a flexor retinaculum. What the heck is a retinaculum? You guys folks from lab should know that. That is like this dense irregular connective tissue band that on your joints, at your wrist and your ankle joints, you're gonna find both flexor and extensor retinaculums. Now imagine me just taking and wrapping like tape around my joint. And then the reason for that is because if I did like forearm flexion, for example, and I didn't have that retinaculum anchoring my tendons down, my tendons would bowstring out. They wouldn't be held in like they are now. They'd literally be like, bark, bark, like coming out, right? So those, and I'll show you an image of this in a moment. Those retinaculums are there for the purpose of anchoring down those tendons of those muscles. So all of these guys with the wrist and the hand and the fingers, we're not gonna get into really deep into the hand and finger muscles. However, the flexors of the wrist and extensors of the wrist, you guys do need to know. In addition to that, we have some pronators and supinators that we need to look at as well. And I'm gonna give you guys one guess what the pronators and supinators are responsible for. So here we have these are the wrist extensors, and it's fairly easy. These are the ones you need to know for lab. This is the flexor carpi ulnaris and extensor digitorum here. Okay. And this is the extensor carpi ulnaris as well. So the flexor carpi ulnaris, although it appears kind of to be on the posterior side, it's more anterior. This is kind of a weird image here. So you need to know about the extensor carpi ulnaris. You need to know about the extensor digitorum and the extensor carpi radialis as well. Those three, and those are very easily seen on the muscle models. You'll have no problem finding those on there. And again, the models are keyed, so that makes things a lot easier for you guys. And you can see here, even with the forearms, now of course we're dealing with a lot smaller muscles than when we're talking about the proximal regions of our limbs, but these are all compartmentalized as well, and you guys should just simply appreciate that.
The origins of supinator are from the lateral epicondyle of the humerus, the radial collateral ligament, the annular ligament, and the supinator crest of the ulna. Fibers run inferiorly and laterally to insert onto the superior one-third of the lateral surface of the radius, including adjacent anterior and posterior surfaces. Supinator supinates the forearm such that the palm turns anterior. It is innervated by the radial nerve.
Okay, so really what you need to get out of this is the supinator supinates. Okay, all of this origin insertion stuff, don't worry about it. You just need to know that if you look at the way this pulls again, everybody, I want to show you again here.
Your surfaces, supinator supinates the forearm.
So if it's connected here to the lateral condyle, epicondyle of the humerus, and it comes over here and inserts on the radius, you guys know that that radius can pivot over. So all it's doing is it's basically going to pull in this direction, pull the radius, and it's going to cause that supination. Okay, watch the action.
Such that the palm turns anterior. It is innervated by the radial nerve.
So you need to know the supinator supinates or causes supination. Well, look, this one is in the supinator was in this direction, was it not? Well, the one that's now antagonistic to the supinator is obviously the pronator. So these aren't exactly on the opposite side of the bone, but you guys kind of get the idea here, hopefully.
Pronator teres has two heads, the humeral head and the ulnar head. The origin of the humeral head is directly superior to the medial epicondyle of the humerus. The origin of the ulnar head is from the medial side of the coronoid process of the ulna. The insertion is to the mid-lateral surface of the radius.
And again, you don't need to know any of that, like the origin insertion of these. You know, the important point is, A, you can point this pronator teres out, and B, you know that it's obviously a pronator. So, and you know, you just need to, and again, this should make total sense. I mean, if you look at the angle of pull, it's going to pull that, the radius, and it's going to cause this. It's going to cause the radius to come over, to pivot over now. So it's causing pronation.
Pronator teres pronates the forearm such that the palm turns posterior. It also assists in flexion of the forearm at the elbow. It is innervated by the median nerve.
Just know that it pronates. So like we said before, these are the ones listed in your lab manual. So we obviously have wrist flexors and we have wrist extensors. These are going to flex the carpal bones like I'm doing right now, or extend the carpal bones like I'm doing right now. And they're pretty simple. You have the flexor carpi radialis, that's obviously going to follow the radial side. The palmaris longus is in the middle, and then the flexor carpi ulnaris is on the ulnar side. And then it's very similar. On the back, we have the extensor digitorum and the extensor carpi radialis longus, and that is, of course, follows the radius as well. So, you know, there are 5 superficial and 3 deep muscles. You only need to know the 3 of the superficial ones. And it's held in place, like I said before, by this flexor retinaculum. It's this tendon is sheath that keeps your tendons from both stringing out. And here it is. If you guys take a look, this is, you know, as if you're looking at your forearm like that. And you can see here that we have this flexor retinaculum that's keeping these muscles from, tendons from both stringing out. Some people, if you guys see this palmaris longus tendon, there are some folks that have the palmaris longus tendon under the retinaculum. And there are some folks that the palmaris longus tendon goes above the retinaculum. And you guys know how to figure that out, right? I did this in lab. You take your thumb and your pinky, put them together, and then you flex your wrist and you look at it. And if you have a tendon sticking out right in the middle of your wrist, that's your palmaris longus tendon. I can't remember the stats. I think it's 30% have it over the retinaculum or something like that. And that's not really that important. So you can see here that these are the ones that I'm making you responsible for. The flexor carpi ulnaris, well, duh, it follows the ulna. The flexor carpi radialis follows the radius, and then we have the one in the middle, the palmaris longus. And I honestly, I can't think of it getting any easier than that. There's simply three muscles there that you need to know. Do not get that confused, any of these confused with the brachioradialis. Remember, this is a forearm flexor. It originates from, you know, the post, the outside of the humerus, and then it runs into the styloid process of the radius. So it has nothing to do with flexing the wrist. It ends at the styloid process of the radius. That's still part, you know, all it does then is that it does this again when you are pronated. When you're more supinated, now your biceps is gonna come into play to a greater degree. Again, your brachioradialis comes into play when you are more pronated. So this is the deep muscles. Again, as far as lab is concerned, I'm not really concerned with these. One of the reasons is you really can't see these very well on the models. Okay. All of these hand structures, as far as very small muscles, as far as the hand are concerned, is with lab. You guys don't need to know any of those guys. Okay. So we have really deep flexors here, and we're just gonna ignore those completely. So we have, of course, extensor muscles on the opposite side of the wrist, and they're held in place by the extensor retinaculum. So you can see those right here. The extensor retinaculum is not present right now, but again, there's gonna be this sheath that goes across the wrist on the back and a sheath that grows across on the front. And the same thing is really true with your ankle as well. You're gonna see those retinaculum on your ankle. So you see the extensor carpi ulnaris here, okay, and then you see the extensor digitorum, and these are the guys that, as far as lab is concerned, that you're going to be tested on. So these are pretty simple. You do have extensors specifically for your thumb, and that's why you can move your thumb independent of all your other fingers. If you extend your fingers, just one of them, the others tend to extend as well. Because that one muscle here, the extensor digitorum, is responsible for the extension overall of your fingers. However, there are individual muscles in here that you give you better control on an individual, you know, extensor or flexor basis for your finger. Then we have intermediate, so we're going even deeper here. I just want you to appreciate, if you look and all of these muscles, we're gonna take these extensors away, the ones that I'm circling here, and now we're left with these guys going even deeper. And so we have this, you can see that we have this extensor indices, and that's specifically for your finger, okay? Your pointer finger, right? Number two. And then you'll notice that you don't have that specific setup for your other fingers, so you have more individual control specifically of your index finger. Also, of course, you'll notice that we have extensors for the pollex along with flexors for the pollex and abductors specifically for the pollex as well. Okay, so now we're getting into new territory. We're done with the upper extremity. We're moving on down to the lower extremity. And so obviously muscles that cross the hip joint are going to move the leg and the thigh. Now listen, thigh and leg, believe it or not, are clinical terms. So when we say the thigh, we're talking about moving the femur, right? And then when we say the leg, we're talking about moving our tibia and fibula around. So please don't screw those up, because on a test, if you think that the leg is this, you're gonna be mistaken. The leg is this. Now I understand this is your entire leg, but when we're talking about movement of, this is considered your thigh, and this is considered your leg only. So it shouldn't be any news to you guys at this point that the anterior muscles flex the femur right at the hip joint and extend the knee, and then the posterior muscles extend the thigh, so they do exactly the opposite and they flex the knee. So again, opposite side of the body now, or and of the bone, and then we're going to have, you know, antagonistic actions going on with these guys. It should also, you know, be no mystery, this is not rocket science, that the medial muscles adduct the thigh, right? They pull the leg inwards, and then there's some muscles, specifically the gluteus medius and minimus, that abduct the thigh, and we'll get there in just a little bit. Okay. Let's just look at them here. So here we go. Start from the top here. First off, let's look at the hip flexors. The hip flexors are just that, they flex the hip. And the major players in the game are known as the iliopsoas group of muscles. That consists of the psoas major and the iliacus. Now there is a psoas minor, but it plays a very minor role, so we're not even gonna go there. We don't even worry about the psoas minor. Psoas major and iliacus. Now both of these muscles merge, and I wish they would have shown this. I guess they will in a second. Those muscles merge onto the lesser trochanter of the femur. That's why it's there. That's why that big knob, the lesser trochanter, exists, is for the purpose of allowing these muscles to attach to it. So those specifically cause hip flexion. And what that means is it's simply taking your thigh and bringing it up like this. This is hip flexion. Then we have the tensor fascia latae. Yes, it's a funky word. And we'll look at the video will show the action of that in just a moment. Now that muscle, along with your gluteus maximus muscle, actually runs into what's known as this IT band here. This is known as your iliotibial band. It's a band from your ilium all the way down into the fascia on the tibia. Here are all the adductors. These are gonna basically adduct the thigh, as the names imply. And then we have the quadriceps group, quad referring to four separate origins. Three out of the four, the vastus medialis, the vastus lateralis, and the vastus intermedius, which is deep to this muscle here, all originate from the femur. And all they do is they insert in the tibial tuberosity and they extend the leg, right? These are your leg extenders. However, there is three out of the four originate from the femur, but that one out of the four, this guy here, this is the rectus femoris. This muscle crosses not only, it originates on the AIIS, so it originates on the anterior inferior iliac spine, and again inserts in the tibial tuberosity. So because this muscle crosses two joints, it is going to have two actions, and that action is not only extending the leg, but it also helps to flex the thigh. It's a synergistic muscle group to the hip flexors here. Then we have the longest muscle in the body. This is the sartorius. And I call this the crossing the leg muscle. You know, when you bring your, you know, leg up like this, this action is sartorius, this. Okay, so let's see all these guys in action here.
The largest muscles in the body are found in the lower limb and the associated hip joint. The hip joint is a ball and socket joint, which, similar to the shoulder joint, is capable of a considerable amount of movement. However, in contrast to the shoulder joint, the muscles of the lower limb are adapted more for strength than precision. Nevertheless, the muscles still show a complex array that can be separated into three categories. Anterior muscles, medial muscles, and posterior muscles.
Okay, let's take a closer look at those.
Flexion of the hip joint results from two prime movers, the iliacus muscle and the psoas major muscle, with the adductor magnus, the pectineus, the adductor brevis, and the adductor longus muscle acting as synergists. Extension results from the adductor magnus as a synergist and the gluteus maximus as the prime mover. Abduction of the hip from the anatomical position results from the gluteus minimus, the gluteus medius, the gluteus maximus, and the tensor fasciae latae. When the hip is already flexed, abduction requires the addition of five more muscles, the gemellus superior, the gemellus inferior, the obturator externus, the obturator internus, and the piriformis.
So those are much smaller, deeper muscles that you just went over.
The primary mover of adduction is the adductor magnus, with the gracilis, the pectineus, the adductor brevis, and the adductor longus acting as synergists. Lateral rotation is a specialty of the six lateral rotators, the gemellus superior, the gemellus inferior, the obturator externus, the obturator internus, the piriformis, and the quadratus femoris. Medial rotation of the hip results from the combined actions of seven muscles, the gluteus minimus and medius, the tensor fasciae latae, the adductor magnus, the gracilis, the pectineus, and the adductor longus.
So, lots going on there.
The two principal anterior muscles of the hip are the iliacus and the psoas major. Collectively, they are known as the iliopsoas muscle because they share a common insertion on the lesser trochanter of the femur. The iliacus muscle originates on the iliac crest and fossa of the pelvis. The psoas major muscle originates on the bodies of vertebrae T12 through L5. And the transverse processes of all lumbar vertebrae.
Iliopsoas is one of a group of nine flexor muscles that cross the hip joint. It consists of three separate muscles, the psoas minor, the psoas major, and the iliacus. Psoas minor is quite small, often absent, and is thus considered an unimportant member of the group. The origins of psoas major are from the vertebral bodies, transverse processes, and intervertebral discs of T12 through L5. The fibers run inferiorly and pass behind the inguinal ligament. They then wrap around the femoral head to insert onto the lesser trochanter. The origins of iliacus are from the superior two-thirds of the iliac fossa. The internal border of the iliac crest and the ala of the sacrum. The fibers converge to insert onto the lesser trochanter with the psoas major tendon. The shared tendon is known as the iliopsoas tendon. With the origin fixed, the iliopsoas flexes the femur onto the trunk. With the insertion fixed and acting bilaterally, it flexes the trunk onto the femur. Psoas major is innervated directly by the lumbar plexus, while the iliacus is innervated by the muscular branch of the femoral nerve.
So notice what they said there. It flexes the thigh on the trunk if it's the thigh comes up, but if the feet stay down, then it flexes the trunk onto the thigh. Okay. Either way, it's taking this and this and bringing them closer together, right? It's flexion going on there.
The origin of sartorius is from the anterior superior iliac spine. The fibers run inferiorly and medially to cross the knee joint and insert onto the medial surface of the proximal tibia. Sartorius flexes the hip and knee joints and laterally rotates the hip joint. It is innervated by the femoral nerve.
So again, longest muscle of the body, this is the crossing the leg joint there. I mean, crossing the leg muscle action. And right here, notice where it said proximal medial tibia. We know that as the pes anserine. There are two other muscles, semimembranosus, tendinosus, those are the part of the hamstring group that inserts in that area as well. So here are abductors and lateral rotators. And you know, I'm not so concerned that you guys know the gluteus maximus and medius, what way they rotate. I'm more concerned with their major action. And the maximus, of course, is the extender of the thigh, right? This is the big daddy, primary mover for thigh extension, and the medius is for abduction. The minimus is for abduction. Now, when you get into lab again next time around and pay attention, you got to picture these muscles where they originate and insert, you will notice that they have a particular line of pull that allows for this type of rotation to take place. Okay, and you know, again, the information that you need to know regarding the rotation is simply in your lab notebook, in that table that I wrote, you know, with all the muscle origin insertion actions. Okay. Obturator externus and internus are lateral rotators of the thigh. You guys should know that. That's something that's important. And then you have the piriformis, that's also a lateral rotator. So these three, gemellus, this is a very small muscle, but all of these guys here act to laterally rotate the thigh. And these are very deep, smaller muscles. Piriformis is perhaps the biggest, the prime mover of lateral rotation.
The origins of tensor fasciae latae are from the anterior surface of the iliac crest.
And I don't know who gave this lady pronunciation tips, but she's totally pronouncing it wrong. I think this is probably almost sounds like a computer generated.
The anterior superior iliac spine. The fibers run inferiorly and insert onto the anterior surface of the lateral condyle of the tibia via the iliotibial tract. The tensor fasciae latae is a tensor muscle acting on the deep fascia or the fascia lata of the thigh. It maintains tension in the iliotibial tract to stabilize both the hip and knee joints. It is innervated by the superior gluteal nerve.
So the tensor fascia latae is just this small sliver of muscle, if you will, and then again it runs into the IT tract or IT band. This IT band, this can very frequently become injured if for people who are like long distance runners, especially people who are long distance bicyclists, because as they continue to do this, the tensor fascia latae runs down and hits this lateral portion of here, yeah? And when they pedal a bike, that IT band goes up and down across the condyle of the femur. So, and then, you know, this repetitive motion of it going up and down and up, above and below, above and below, above and below, that can actually cause friction. This is what IT band friction syndrome is. Okay? So for you folks that are, you know, hardcore bikers, cyclists, not like a motorcycle, obviously, that's a very common injury to have.
The posterior muscles that cross the hip joint begin with six deep muscles that are collectively referred to as the lateral rotators, named for their action on the femur. They are the gemellus superior, the gemellus inferior, the obturator externus, the obturator internus, the piriformis, and the quadratus femoris. Superficial to the lateral rotators are the three gluteal muscles, the gluteus minimus, the gluteus medius, and the gluteus maximus. And located laterally is the tensor fasciae lactae.
Okay, so you guys can read that on your own. You'll notice that you can see here that, you know, if you look at the action, look at the action of the gluteus maximus, that's a lot. So what I've done, again, in the lab notebook is I've taken this and I've condensed it as much as I possibly could, but still trying to get the point across. So when it comes to that, just pay attention to the action in your lab notebook. It's a little more condensed than what you're seeing here. Okay. Now, we talked about leg extenders, lateral medial rotators, flexors. Now we're moving down now to muscles that is going to affect the knee joint. And that's, we already talked about the, or we've seen the quadriceps, we haven't gotten into that much detail on them. And then the hamstring group, or your hammies, right? Those are the muscles that are in the posterior region of the thigh, and those are primarily knee flexors. And we'll take a look at those individually. So you can see here, this is gluteus maximus, and then you can look on the posterior region. Let's not worry about the adductors at the moment. However, you can see this is the portion of the hamstring, the biceps femoris long head, the semimembranosus, and semitendinosus. These three muscles are considered the hamstring group. There is a fourth muscle in the back of the femur, the biceps femoris short head, but that originates directly from the posterior femur. Okay, it's not considered part of the hamstring group.
The gluteus maximus is the large fleshy muscle that forms the bulk of the buttock. The origins of gluteus maximus are from the posterior ilium, sacrum, coccyx, and the sacrotuberous ligament.
So
some deep fibers insert onto the gluteal tuberosity of the femur. However, the majority of the fibers insert onto the iliotibial tract of the fascia lata. The gluteus maximus is the most powerful extensor of the thigh at the hip. It also assists in lateral rotation of the thigh. It is innervated by the inferior gluteal nerve.
So, again, the takeaway here is the gluteus maximus is the big primary extender of the thigh. It also is involved just a touch in lateral rotation of the femur. Now you'll notice when we go to the minimus and medius, you're going to see a different angle of pull, and therefore we're going to have a little bit different action going on with these guys.
The origin of gluteus medius is from the posterior ilium inferior to the iliac crest. The insertion is to the lateral surface of the greater trochanter of the femur. The gluteus medius abducts and medially rotates the thigh. Along with gluteus minimus, it also stabilizes the pelvis laterally. It is innervated by the superior gluteal nerve.
Now, to me, this has always confused me too. It appears as though it'd be a lateral rotator of the thigh, but in fact, it's a medial rotator. So, speaking of lateral rotators, all of these guys that you see here, these deeper muscles, these are all lateral rotators. And you can see very clearly, if I pull on this thigh, and it's gonna cause the thigh to move from my right thigh, right? It would cause my thigh to do this, and that's lateral rotation. So these are primarily the rotators. It's not the larger muscles. So obturator internus is also a lateral rotator. It's kind of hard to see with this picture, but this muscle, you know, the obturator foramen, that hole created by the pubis and the ischium, that's covered with muscle. There's an obturator externus and an internus, and they both the fibers go posterior to the femur. So when it pulls, you can see again, it's going to laterally rotate the femur outwards. Okay. And then we have the adductors, and it's basically, in general, they run from the pubic ischial area to the linea spera, and that thing in the back of that long, broad line, that kind of like a crest in the back of the femur, well, that's where the adductors insert. They medially rotate the thigh, but basically what you guys need to know about all of these guys, all of them, is they are adductors. And the big daddy one here, the one that is the prime mover, is the magnus. Magnus means large, right? That is a very thick, large muscle that runs almost the entire, inserts the entire length of the linea spera. And like I said before, this is, you know, called, you know, in sports they call this the groin region, which didn't make sense to me at all because the groin region technically is much higher than that. But, you know, if you pull your groin muscle, they're referring to one of these adductors here.
There are five medial muscles that cross the hip joint. The adductor magnus.
Big one.
The pectineus. The adductor brevis. And the adductor longus. The adductor magnus originates on the inferior ramus of the pubis, as well as the ramus and tuberosity of the ischio. The muscle inserts on the linea aspera, the gluteal tuberosity, and the medial supracondylar line of the femur.
You guys just need to know the linea spera.
The gracilis muscle originates on the body and inferior ramus of the pubis, and the ramus of the ischium. The insertion is on the medial surface of the tibia, just below the tibial condyle. The pectineus muscle originates on the superior ramus of the pubis and inserts on the spiral line of the femur. The adductor brevis originates on the body and inferior ramus of the pubis and inserts on the linea aspera of the femur. The adductor longus originates on the body and inferior ramus of the pubis, near the pubic symphysis, and inserts on the linea aspera of the femur, below the adductor brevis.
And here they are again. They're adductors. They adduct the leg. So we're moving on now to the frontal leg, the quadricep muscles. Everybody knows your quads, right? Again, quad meaning there's four origin points. Three of the four only cross the knee. One out of the four crosses both the hip and the knee. And then it inserts these quadricep tendons, run into the patella, and then from the patella it's considered a patellar ligament. Because what is a ligament? It's bone to bone. What is a tendon? It's muscle to bone. I'll show you that in just a moment. So here they are again. Vastus lateralis, medialis, intermedius is right underneath the rectus femoris here, and then of course we have the rectus femoris. This again being the only one that crosses two joints. So if you go deeper, the vastus lateralis is, you can see it's lateral. The vastus intermedius, believe it or not, is in between. And then the vastus medialis is medial. Now, I'm not going to get into, if you analyze the movement of these, you can look at, you know, for example, the vastus medialis is responsible for the last 30 degrees of extension. So above right here to up. Okay, so all of these muscles play a role in extending the leg. And they kind of fire at, or contract, if you will, and they're responsible for a particular range of motion of this leg extension.
The rectus femoris is the anterior member of the muscle group of the anterior thigh, known as the quadriceps femoris. Rectus femoris has two tendons. The straight tendon originates from the anterior inferior iliac spine and gives rise to the straight head. The reflected tendon originates from a groove superior to the rim of the acetabulum and gives rise to the reflected head. The fibers run inferiorly to insert onto the superior border of the patella and to the tibial tuberosity via the patellar ligament.
So you see here, this would be the quadriceps tendon, and that quadriceps from all of them are going to merge in here to the patella, and then from the patella to the tibial tuberosity, because this is considered bone to bone, then it's just technically called the patellar ligament. It's really the same tissue, but we're calling it a ligament because it's bone to bone, not muscle to bone.
The rectus femoris flexes the thigh at the hip.
So again, this one being the only one of the quads that cross the hip joint, well, obviously there's going to be some action on the hip joint as well, and it's a little bit of hip flexion. You know, this is a synergistic muscle to your primary movers, which are your iliopsoas, or your hip flexors, right?
And extends the leg at the knee. It is innervated by the femoral. Vastus lateralis is the lateral member of the muscle group of the anterior thigh, known as the quadriceps femoris. The origins of vastus lateralis are from the greater trochanter. The intertrochanteric line and the lateral lip of the linea aspera of the femur. The fibers run inferiorly to insert onto the quadriceps femoris tendon, the superior and lateral borders of the patella, and to the tibial tuberosity via the patellar ligament. Vastus medialis is the medial member of the muscle group of the anterior thigh, known as the quadriceps femoris. The origins of vastus medialis are from the intertrochanteric line of the anteromedial femur, from the linea aspera, and the medial supracondylar line of the posterior femur. The fibers run inferiorly to insert onto the quadriceps femoris tendon, the superior and medial borders of the patella, and to the tibial tuberosity via the patellar ligament. The vastus medialis extends the leg at the knee. It is innervated by the femoral nerve. Vastus intermedius is the intermediate and deep member of the muscle group of the anterior thigh, known as the quadriceps femoris. The origins of vastus intermedius are from the anterior and lateral surfaces of the shaft of the femur. The fibers run inferiorly to insert onto the deep part of the superior border of the patella and to the tibial tuberosity via the patellar ligament. The vastus intermedius extends the leg at the knee. It is innervated by the femoral nerve.
Okay, so quadriceps extend the leg, okay? So hamstrings are obviously on the opposite side of the bone, therefore they're going to be exactly antagonistic of the quadriceps. And they cross the hip and knee joints, so they're going to have at least two actions on both of these joints. And they're flexors of the knee, okay? That's their big role in things. It's their agonistic movement is flexion of the knee. They're innervated by the sciatic nerve. And it says here a pulled hamstring is very common in sports injuries. Well, and I think I probably mentioned this to at least a few of you, you know, if you look at the quadriceps muscle on the front and you compare that big fat muscle group to these hamstrings in the back, you obviously right away you can see which ones are going to be overwhelmed, and it's the hamstring group. So, you know, people that are in sports like that require any type of like sprinting, you know, very quick running, you know, or sprinters, the most common injury for sprinters is what? It's this, it's a strained hamstring. For, you know, for us old folks, this is, you know, I go out and play baseball sometimes with my buddies, and I'm like, all right, well, we'll just play until someone gets injured. And this is typically what stops the game from going on, is someone pulls a hamstring. Okay, here it is. So this is the, again, you have this kind of, this hamstring group going on each side of the leg. There's a medial component and there's a lateral component. And the medial component consists of what's known as the semitendinosus, and there's a semimembranosus. And you know, if you were to see this, this is times I really wish we had a cadaver, because when you look at these and you tease these out, the semitendinosus like literally turns into, there's a muscle belly way up here in the femoral region, and then there's literally a tendon that runs the majority of the way down and then inserts on the lateral condyle of the tibia, the fibula. And then we have the semimembranosus, which runs just deep to that. That's on the medial side. Remember that, because on the lateral side, you have the long head of the biceps femoris. You also have a short head, and that does help flex the knee. However, the short head, I repeat, is not considered part of the hamstrings, because the short head does not originate the same place the other three do. The other three originate at the ischial tuberosity, okay? So like I said before, these are the hamstrings that you're seeing here.
Biceps femoris is the lateral member of the muscle group located in the posterior thigh, known as the hamstrings. Biceps femoris has two heads, the long head and the short head. The origin of the long head is by a common tendon with a semitendinosus from the superior and medial surfaces of the ischial tuberosity. The origins of the short head are from the lateral lip of the linea aspera and the lateral supracondylar line of the femur. The fibers run inferiorly and laterally to insert primarily onto the lateral surface of the fibular head, but it also inserts on the adjacent surface of the lateral condyle of the tibia. Both heads of the biceps femoris flex the leg and the knee. And laterally rotate the knee.
And don't worry about that. That's such a small component. We're not even going to go there.
The long head also extends the thigh at the hip. The long head is innervated by the tibial nerve. The short head is innervated by the common fibular nerve.
Almost done, guys.
Semitendinosus lies posterior to semimembranosus and is the most superficial member of the muscle group located in the posterior thigh, known as the hamstrings. The origins of semitendinosus are by a common tendon with the long head of the biceps femoris from the superior and lateral surfaces of the ischial tuberosity. The fibers run inferiorly to insert onto the medial surface of the proximal tibia. Semitendinosus extends the thigh at the hip and flexes the leg at the knee. It also medially rotates the knee during flexion. Semitendinosus is innervated by the tibial nerve.
One more.
Semimembranosus is the medial member of the muscle group located in the posterior thigh, known as the hamstring.
That's all we need to know. Semimembranosus, semitendinosus, medial, hamstring, biceps femoris long head, lateral, hamstring. Biceps for more short head, lateral, but not part of the hamstring group. Okay, we're done a little bit earlier. Okay, so like I said, there's open lab today. You guys are welcome to come, and then we'll just have the normal schedule for open lab for the rest of the week. That's posted on the lab board. And then next week, we're gonna have, 1:30 to 3:30 Monday, Wednesday. And then Thursday, 12 to 3. Okay. Thanks, guys. Have a great day.